welcome to Dawai Kudroen. My guest tonight is Honorable Chairperson of Druk Holding and Investment, Dasho Sangay Khandu. Dasho, thank you so much for your time and welcome to the program. Dasho, we have had a lengthy discussion during Zonka session, so maybe I'll just straight away jump to a question that I have not asked you during Zonka session. One thing that people who are working in those corporations or those companies that are under DHI feel that the role played by these companies are actually duplicated by the role played by Druk Holding and Investment, DHI. Your comment on this?
See, DHI is a holding company, while the other corporations or companies are subsidiaries, which means that the holding company is actually the owner. The others are the companies that are actually doing the work on the field.
Yes.
And the main function of the DHI vis-a-vis the operating companies, just our job is to see opportunities for new business, the monitor and improve the governance of the existing companies, and also to ensure that the services which the existing companies are required to deliver are delivered properly and effectively and efficiently. And there are measures put in place, systems put in place to monitor the performance of each of these companies.
Yes.
So that is one of the major differences. We don't implement or do anything at the DHI level as such. Our job is to take investment decisions and do monitoring and supervision, while each of these companies are given certain mandate to deliver the services, to make profit on goods and sales of services.
Yes. Dasho, from what I learned, DHI is actually strictly monitoring, evaluating, and even regulating those companies that are under DHI. These things do not really seem to go well with some of the companies, some of the management of the companies.
I guess in some of the companies may be feeling a little uncomfortable with it, but some of the companies that are performing well and feel that whatever good work they do, they feel that there must be somebody to recognize their output.
Yes.
So in the past, before the DHI was established, each of these companies, as of now, also have their individual boards. And the boards normally meet once in 3 months. And the management put up the issues to the board and seek approval and sanctions and so forth. And once the board is, meetings are over, the CEO does what he feels best.
Yes.
And as long as he can keep the board happy, he gets away with whatever does it. Because the board is an institution that is existing at the time when it is in a meeting to decide certain issues and address certain concerns. But after the meeting is over, they feel that they are not, after that, responsible for it.
Yes.
But when DHI is there, it oversees the not only the how the board is supervising the performance of individual companies, but we also set benchmarks for service to be delivered.
Yes.
Profitability of the companies are monitored. Like even if you go into a totally commercial organization which has profit as a profit-oriented company, we set up profit per employee. We do not control the number of employees, the people they want to employ, but we say that profit per employee. So if they need to recruit more people, they are free to do so, but they must also increase their profit and revenue. So when somebody is being monitored closely and compacts are signed to monitor and measure their both financial performance and non-financial performance, some people don't feel too happy about it.
Yes. So the CEOs of these companies are fully under the radar of DHI, and that they cannot do things at their whims and fancies, which they enjoyed in the past, is what you're saying, sir.
Well, it also again depends upon the sense of responsibility each of the CEOs took. most of the CEOs who have very high sense of responsibility and who are performing now, who performed even in the past, they feel that they feel even better.
Yes.
They feel that at least there's somebody who appreciates the output and the, you know, good job, and they get performance-based variable allowances, bonus, according to the output.
Yes.
In the past, these systems were not put in place. In fact, I myself served as a CEO of four or five companies from 1976 to mid 2005,
yes,
off and on. Even if I did did a good job, some of the companies were on the verge of bankruptcy. You know, I managed to get these companies out of red and revive these companies, but there was no recognition then. But today, at least, there's somebody to recognize that. And you also have a 25% of your financial remuneration is based on your performance.
Yes. Dasho, another thing, you're talking about those advantages that these companies and the employees enjoy because of what DHI was doing, actually. But on the other hand, there will also be people who would be feeling that the establishment of DHI and the kind of roles and responsibilities that DHI share is nothing but a creation of another bureaucratic hassle.
Mm-hmm.
And for every little decision, these companies have to consult DHI, seek approval. So they might be feeling uncomfortable because of this.
Well, the creation of DHI was not just to monitor the performance of the companies.
Yes.
But the most of these companies, some are, of course, totally social-oriented and profit-oriented. There are others profit-oriented. There are companies which generate a lot of revenue. But DHI was created as a holding company to manage the natural resources which belongs to the people of Bhutan,
yes,
and must be utilized and in the most efficient manner in the interests of the present generation as well as for the future.
Yes.
In order to do this, whatever income that is generated now in the past goes directly to the Ministry of Finance and was spent on an annual basis. And when the DHI was created, the revenue that is earned by these companies coming to the holding company, and then what DHI retained is not what was being given to paid to Ministry of Finance, but it was additional revenue that DHI managed to get out of the companies by improving the efficiencies.
Yes.
And then that additional revenue is being built into a reserve, which the DHI plans to multiply for further investments in the interest of the present and the future generation of Bhutan. So holding company is basically a company that is the investment arm of the government, so that our futures are a little more secure than what we are now. Because today, DHI and its companies contribute probably 34% of the government revenue. But we are today doing most of the capital investments through grants and aids from outside. But how long can we continue? Will that be coming on a perpetual basis? We need to ask ourselves. But if you are able to effectively utilize investment, reinvest, and generate more revenue and income for this in the future, even if in the future times to come, even if the donor assistance drop, we should be prepared for it. And that's one of the main objectives of the DHI.
Yes. Dasho, one of the mechanisms that DHI put in place in order to motivate the employees of this companies is that you have mentioned about the performance-based variable allowance. This must be a welcome news for these companies. But how strictly do you monitor and evaluate who actually deserves this performance-based variable allowance?
See, the system of performance-based variable allowances is highest at the CEO level because he is the key person in the organization.
Yes.
His 25% of the pay is determined on that.
Yes.
The rest of the employees is 10%. When these variable allowances are tied to the compact that we sign with DHI signs with each company. But what are the components of the compact, both financial and non-financial, are first proposed by the company themselves.
Yes.
And if there are some critical factors that the company and its board have not included in the compact, DHI Corporate Performance Department ensures that these are included in the compact. And based on this, this is strictly monitored in the sense that each of these criteria has a score.
Yes.
And all these scores are added and they have to achieve certain percentage, say minimum is 70% of the total score.
Yes.
If you achieve below 70%, the whole company, nobody gets it. But after 70%, then it depends on 70 to 80%, maybe you get 25% of that 25. And then as you go up, the chances of you getting whole 25% also exist depending upon your performance.
Yes.
So in this case, first is at the, between the DHI and the companies.
Yes.
Then the management breaks this down into divisions in the department according to the job responsibilities. So then from the department, it trickles down to individual also.
Yes.
So it depends on the nature of work. So once, because each individual performance has an effect on the CEO's allowances. Because if one person doesn't deliver, the CEO's performance is affected. So that's why it is, unlike in many other organizations, in where this performance are very strictly monitored, these individuals are also strictly supervised by the individual, you know, section heads or division chiefs and the department heads.
Yes. So have you started implementing this strictly? Any
oh, yeah, this has
unpleasant
been
experience that you had to go through as the new chairman?
But I mean, there has been no serious, unpleasant thing. But there are cases when they appeal to their board.
Yes.
And their board submitted an appeal to the, you know, DHI board. Because in one company in the beginning of 2014, they appealed. So, because they didn't get the performance PBBA at all.
Yes.
So they appealed to this thing. The board, DHI board rejected. They resubmitted the appeal on giving 101 justifications. The DHI board asked the corporate performance department of the DHI see that whether you have made any mistake in the calculations. Or but everything was right and proper. Therefore, they didn't get. So of course, the company employees were not happy with DHI board. And in particular, the corporate performance department, who are very strict on this.
Yes. Dasho, you have put mechanisms in place for these companies to deliver better services, to deliver on the targets that have been set. Good for DHI to monitor and evaluate all these companies. But who is actually monitoring and evaluating people working for DHI?
Well, for DHI, the CEO and the chairman, we sign a compact with our board.
Yes.
So if the where the DHI is not able to fulfill its commitment,
yes,
in terms of the dividend compact that we signed with Ministry of Finance, if you're not able to meet that,
yes,
or there are, and then others, there are other many others, and this one among many, then the CEO and the chairman's PBBA is based on this performance that we signed with the board.
Yes.
The rest of the employees below CEO are signed with the CEO and the other members of the, the other employees. And these are submitted to the DHI board.
Yes.
And then whether the CEO has done this accurately and fairly and squarely is submitted to the board after the CEO has done his job.
Yes. Dasho, will this not be the case of the example that Dasho cited, that earlier the companies, the CEOs of the companies used to keep the board happy and that's it, and he can walk away with whatever he feels like doing. Will this not be the same with DHL, the chairperson and the CEO of DHI keeping the board happy and then can walk away?
Well, for us, more than the board is our primary shareholder, which is the Ministry of Finance, And the crux of this matter, the whole thing, is the final dividend that we pay to Ministry of Finance. The board may be happy with us, but if you're not able to pay the money at the end of every month, end of the year, to Ministry of Finance in commitment, doesn't matter what the board does about it, it is that we have already failed in our duty if you are not able to meet that commitment.
Yes. Yes. Dasho, you mentioned in Zonka session that the major chunk of revenue is submitted to the Ministry of Finance and not much left with DHI. Mm. So if you do not have much money left with DHI, then what about some of the corporate social responsibilities that people expect DHI to deliver?
Well, when you talk of DHI, we are, as we said, there is a holding company. Each of these subsidiary companies has a budget built in into their own annual budget.
Yes.
As a part of their, depending upon the corporate social responsibility they are required to shoulder, is already built into the budget. So that is expanded from the individual company's budget, and DHI does not have a hand in it. DHI as a holding company, we have in fact a very, very negligible amount for this. But each of the company has their own budget.
Yes. Dasho, two companies again added to the list of companies that DHI is taking control over, Woodcraft Center and Construction Development Corporation Limited. These two companies also were mandated by the Ministry of Finance and the government to create employment, and also there are other mandates. So don't you think this would affect the profit making concept and the mandate of DHL by having these two companies added?
Well, these two companies do not have much liability.
Less.
In fact, they should be more profit oriented rather than any social mandate.
Yes.
Only thing that the responsibility that these two companies have is to lead by example. Like in the case of Woodcraft, we say that Woodcraft will train people, Buddhist citizen people, and make those trained furniture makers available for the wood-based industries to be employed.
Yes.
That's a social mandate. But at the same time, the services of these people will be used by Woodcraft Center to manufacture simultaneously to use their skills. So it's on-the-job training. That's one of the reasons why government is in the business of manufacturing wooden furniture, not because it's just to make money, but to train people in the wood-based furniture making to make these people available to the private. That's one.
Yes.
Number two, in the process, we want to demonstrate to the private sector that, yes, we can run a furniture-making industry with 100% Bhutanese.
Yes.
That you don't need to import skilled people from outside, which our private sector is crying all the time.
Yes.
Saying they don't get the required manpower.
Yes.
And this is one of the objectives, to create employment, add value to our timber, add value to the services that we can provide. And it is not only train people, not only to produce the furniture. As of now, we are doing it only in the country. But if you are able to enhance our capacity, improve our quality and efficiency, one of the mandate for DHI is to improve the efficiency of our companies to be able to compete at the regional and international level. But we have to improve the economics of scale.
Yes.
So similarly, in the construction development, Corporation Limited, CDCL, is that we are trying to promote this company to specialize in two things.
Yes.
Which today our private sector has, in the last 40 years of development, has not been able to build its capacity. In spite of the entire construction industry is being left to the totally to the private.
Yes.
I think government has decided that again we have to lead by example, saying that it is possible. Number one, with the topography that we have in Bhutan, every two places there is a stream or a river, the number of bridges that are to be constructed is immense. It can only grow. And for all the permanent bridges that are required to be constructed, we have to get experts from outside. Our contractors are not competent just now, don't have the technical capacity to construct permanent bridges.
Yes.
So we want CDCL to specialize in construction of permanent bridges. That's one. Number two, today there are people are saying that hydropower construction is creating, some tend to believe that this is one of the reasons why there is a rupee crunch, which is not the case actually, because this rupee almost balances out. But what is happening is we are not able to take advantage of the investment that is made in our own country. So of course, if $35 billion is invested into Pune One, out of that, how much are we able to retain here? But if 34.99 goes back, then what are we left with?
Yes.
That is the question. But if we are able to retain the investments, with the size of investment that is being made into three hydropower projects, our Bhutan's economy should be flourishing.
Yes.
It should have a tremendous growth rate. But because we are not able to retain the investments here, the goods and services are not produced by Bhutan. Every rupee that is spent, the 99 chatra, paisa goes out because we are not able to produce the goods and services. So now what we are trying to do with CDCL is that the build the capacity of this company to be able to undertake hydropower construction in the future. That also with 100% Bhutanese.
No, sir. Dasho, final question, especially with reference to these two companies. Enhancing and the capacity of these two companies would be one thing, but it would be quite another to see that DHI, by enhancing these two companies, is eating into the businesses of the private companies. You might be facing this criticism.
Well, as far as CDCL is concerned, the area that I'm talking of, our private sector is not there at all. In fact, we want to build that company because our private sector is not there. Once we set this up properly, if private sector wants to participate, we will be offloading some of the shares.
Yes.
And private sector can participate in terms of shareholding.
Yes.
But first we want to introduce this and build that capacity up. And with regard to the woodcraft, yes, the wood-based industry and the private sector has a lot of criticism on it.
Yes.
They're saying that all the government orders are being taken by woodcraft. But I think our economy is much bigger than the what woodcraft is capable of doing.
Yes.
Our private sector is sometimes looking at very narrowly. If you go through the statistics, you can imagine how many millions worth of Ngultrums of furniture that we are importing. If they go through the statistics, then you can you realize that there is space in Bhutan for another 10-15 woodcraft centers.
Yes.
So private sector should try to work towards that. And in fact, I've also mentioned during the government-private meet forum that I think we should work together.
Yes.
The DHI, I mean, the through the woodcraft, we will support, we will guide you. Let's work as a team. We will demonstrate how it can be done.
Are they willing?
Well, they have their own, you know, the private sector had always have something that has a different game plan. So there are sometimes differences, and we can't do what they do all the time.
Yes, yes. Yes. Honorable Chairperson of DHI, Dasho Sangay Khandu, thank you so much for your time, Dasho. Mm. With this, we come to the end of Dawai Kudroen. Thank you so much for watching, and good night. Dasho.